Hello, JMIR followers. This is Dr. Jennifer Joe, JMIR ambassador. And today I'm delighted to be interviewing Mr. Tim Nguyen with the Emergency Preparedness Division of the World Health Organization on his recent JMIR Infodemiology original paper, Infodemic Signal Detection During the COVID-19 Pandemic, Development of a Methodology for Identifying Potential Information Voids in Online Conversation. Mr. Tim Nguyen is the head of Unit for High Impact Events in the Global Infectious Hazard Preparedness Department of the WHO Health Emergency Program. His team manages the WHO Information Network for Epidemics, a platform to unite the work on managing disease infodemic during emergencies and the strategic global governance of pharmaceutical interventions, including pandemic influenza and smallpox vaccine, as well as influenza antivirals. This is such an important paper, and I want to say a big thank you to Tim and the World Health Organization for doing this, and welcome, Tim.
Thank you, Jennifer. I'd like to be here with you.
First, I just want to start with the background. You published in JMIR Infodemiology, and this is a big word, I think, that many of our viewers don't totally know what it means. So generally, big picture, can you describe what infodemiology is and why it's important?
Thank you. I'm happy to, you know, really give my perspective on how I understand infodemiology and why it's important. First of all, you know, I work for the WHO, so we are very focused on what can we do in the field and how can we really mitigate the health impact of epidemics, and in this case, the COVID-19 pandemic. And we identified that we need to do interventions that are evidence-based. And, you know, we created this program here during the COVID-19 pandemic. We called Infodemic Management. So infodemic, on one hand, is really what we see, the overabundance of information that includes mis- and disinformation. So people are overwhelmed with this kind of information types that may lead to certain behavior that impact the health. And I think we want to mitigate this. So we created this program of infodemic management. And for us, it's important that the interventions we apply are evidence-based. And we believe that infodemiology is the scientific basis for infodemic management. And this is why, you know, we consider, when it comes to the science and how we better understand the interventions that are most impactful, we apply the science of infodemiology.
Can you walk us through the methodology that was used in this paper and how you developed it, how it works, and the structure of it?
The basic idea is, how do we create a taxonomy that automates and categorizes the millions of posts out there so we can more quickly analyze them when we understand what are the major themes? So what we created were four overarching categories, and then divided this in further 35 subcategories. And the way we created the major themes is really along the key questions we observe and see in every epidemic. These are: what is the cause of the virus? Where is it coming from? The second is really, what is the disease that is causing it? How can it be treated? The next categories is really, what are the interventions out there that can be done by public health or individuals? And the fourth category, what are the treatments that is out there? These are the four key questions we see in every epidemic, where questions arise and where answers need to be fulfilled. So we applied this categorization. And then specifically for the COVID-19, we try to identify the sub-themes around this. Once we have established this categorization, we then applied, you know, a search string, a Boolean search string methodology around that with keywords, so that from a social media fire hose, we could then stream that information with natural language processing to these categories. And once we had, you know, this graph categorization, then a human analyst could come in and look at these buckets of categories and see what are the major questions or themes that are evolving in these categories, and then how to summarize then, you know, five 1,000 posts around now what we see into this subtheme and see, okay, we see that there's three issues that are coming out of this subcategory. And this helps then to categorize and inform us in terms of what are the hot topics, what are the key questions, and where people are having questions.
That's fantastic. And has a structure like this been developed before, or are you really the pioneers of this particular structure, or is this unique and different for various reasons?
This is unique for public health. I haven't seen this before, somebody doing this, or I haven't published yet on this methodology. I think you see this a lot when it comes to product placement, you know, commercial companies really, you know, want to know what users or clients are thinking about the products. So probably in the commercial sector, similar typology or methodology approaches are being used. And also for a reputational risk assessment, you know, what people are talking about my brand or my company. But in terms of public health and applying this to an infovalence approach, I think this is unique and hasn't been applied before. So I think we're the first out there to publish on such a taxonomy and methodology.
That's very exciting. And I hope that other public health officials can take this, replicate it, and learn from it. Specifically with COVID, can you walk us through some examples of after setting up the methodology, doing the scan, what were the most interesting, useful findings from the COVID-19 analysis?
I think first, the primary, you know, findings for us is it can be done. You know, we looked here in the 18 months period now, almost about 1 billion posts that are COVID related. And you can really categorize, you know, this huge amount of posting into the system that help you guide what are the issues around there. I think that's first of all, as a feasibility, it's possible and this is demonstrated. So this is, you know, the first, you know, key findings I would like to highlight. I think second, what we've seen is returning narratives. I think, you know, on one time, you know, one certain narrative about, let's say, a treatment option becomes hot. And then suddenly, 2 weeks later, it's a different narrative. But you can see that at certain times, certain narratives reappear because it signals two things. The first thing is that the communication to resolve this has not been maybe good enough to reach audience. So it's important then to relook at your risk communication and the kind of guidance you have given to see how can you be more narrow and adapt this. The second thing we have seen is that narratives move from country to country at a certain time. Countries are not in the same pandemic response phase. And what applies, you know, to country X at one certain point reappears in another country at a different time point. So this also helps us what has been applied in one context can be reapplied then a different context when it comes to disseminating this kind of information. So I think that's another important outcome that we've seen. So we can really reuse what we use for country X in terms of risk communication for a country Y in a different situation at a different time frame.
So here I am sharing the World Health Organization early AI supported response with social listening ears dashboard. This is a COVID-19 online conversation in 20 pilots. And the purpose is to listen to people's questions and concerns in an important way for health authorities to learn about what matters to communities in response to COVID-19. So this over here is just overall what people are talking about. Are they talking about COVID-19 vaccines? Are they talking about transmission settings? Are they talking about testing? And then over here, you can look at the trends of intensity per country. Down below, you can actually organize and track these particular trends and also look at them per country. So if we take the United States and we look at what are the dark colored boxes, which are the highest and what is trending right now, we can see that 4.1% of people in the United States are talking about the environment, 0.6% are talking about pandemic fatigue, 2.5% are talking about myths, 0.7% are talking about other discuss symptoms. And you can see how the United States, in terms of this data that's being collected, is trending for topics as compared to other countries that are in this pilot. We really appreciate that you've contributed and really addressing this important issue. This concludes our interview. Thank you to author Tim Nguyen with the Emergency Preparedness Division of the World Health Organization for taking the time to talk with us today on his JMIR Infodemiology original paper, Infodemic Signal Detection During the COVID-19 Pandemic, Development of a Methodology for Identifying Potential Information Voids in Online Conversation. Thank you to the JMIR followers. For more great research like this, be sure to go to jmirpublications.com, where all of our articles are open access. No matter who you are or where you are in the world, you always have free access to the full article.